We can't hear you. You're muted, Jam. I mean, Cam. Here we go. Thank you.
I'm so happy.
all love that, because I sure did. But guess what? We got something special for you.
Yes, we do.
Go ahead, Bill.
Thank you.
Walk right up to you and say,
I'm over here fangirling out so much I couldn't even unmute myself.
Right? Me either. Me. I was like, oh, okay.
You so silly.
You can't talk till I introduce you. You're out of line already.
Too late. Okay.
Be quiet. 10 seconds, Phil. 10 seconds, Phil. 10 seconds.
You and I go back so I can interrupt you. Trust me.
So let her give you the formal introduction for our beautiful family.
I'll be nice. I'll be nice.
Thank you.
Okay. Me and Lynn, we thought long and hard about this. So come on, Phil. He's a platinum and gold selling artist. You've heard him over the years in TV, radio commercials, in some of your favorite films. And now he is here with us on the DJ Project, our friend, our brother, Philip Ingram, y'all. Give him a DJ Project welcome.
Hello, okay, there. So now you can put yourself back in. Yes, there we go.
No, wasn't that worth waiting for?
Yeah, that was like, oh yeah, thank you. I'm so glad I waited for that. No.
I just want to say, you know, that opening note that you opened on that video, I should have asked you, can you just do that for us before I ask you any questions?
Well, you know, that's the Ingram thing. Because James, when he started doing stuff, he said he needed a trademark. And so we used to do stuff, you know, in our local days. And so he started doing that. It was like, so that became his trademark. If you remember every song he did,
he sure did. So,
it's an Ingram thing, so I can steal it.
Okay.
That's all it was, girl.
Okay, so before you ask your first question, what I would
Look, it's Lady Coco's turn. No,
it is, but go ahead. Guess what? I'm still coming in here. Thank you.
What you got to do? He's out of control already.
I know. Okay, you all don't know what we went through. Comprehend, okay? But it was wonderful. I just want y'all to know it was wonderful. But what I'd like for you to do, since you played that wonderful interview, wonderful song for us, introduce the members that we don't know that was with Original Switch.
Right.
With the Original Switch or that's
both? That was on the video. Those who were part of the original group, but also those who were joining you on the video.
Got you. Well, the original members that still do shows is myself, Eddie Fluellen, and also Gregory Williams. And those are the three that you saw. Those ones was also on the album covers. But also the guitar player, his name is Michael McGlory. He's the guitar solo on They'll Never Be, I'll Call Your Name. He was actually Jermaine Jackson's guitar player at the time. But now he does shows with us. If you look back at an old Soul Train, you'll actually see him there playing with us. So really, he's like an original member. Then the bass player is Dion Estes, if you look him up. He's played with everybody and they mama as well. He's he was actually like the third member of Michael. What's his name? George Michael's band.
Wham.
Yeah. Wham. He's part of Wham. He toured with them. Toured with George Michael and a whole bunch of folks. And then Tafir Hazy was the drummer, and he's done a lot of work with LTD, and he also works with us. But Akili, of course, you know Bobby DeBarge. He died. March of 1995, and so Akili Nixon was the closest that we could find that, you know, kind of had that DeBarge sound.
Yeah, he was hitting them notes.
Yes, it was.
I mean, L as well, but you know, L has his own thing. DeBarge has their own thing. So Akili just been a nice little fit. So, so with that, you know, that's why it sounds like it does, because pretty much everybody's there.
Okay, yeah. I just wanted to make sure that they had their flowers as well. So,
and that video that you showed, what's that from? Like, why did you make it?
We did when the lockdown first happened. You know, a lot of bands were doing stuff, or I should say, artists, and so we decided to do a at home with Switch, and we're going to do a few little series, which is a couple of songs, because we don't know how long this lockdown is going to be, and so. We decided to do that, and we said, let's pick an older hit. So that was the second hit from our first album. And then the second song we did, which you're not going to see, but anyway, that was one of the newer songs.
Okay. Yeah.
But it's on my website. So if they want to see it, you can go to philipingram.org.
Look at him jumping all ahead. Talking about his website already. We're going to get to that. anyway, that was awesome. At Home with Switch. And you said you're going to do a series. So that's cool. That's something to look forward to.
I think the next one's going to be They'll Never Be.
Okay, one question. Someone asked about Tommy DeBarge. Is he still...
You said you want to ask a question. What's the question?
They just said Tommy DeBarge. But I'm going to form it into a question for you, since that is what you are requesting. Is Tommy DeBarge still performing? We know he was not on the video, so... Does he perform with you guys, or is he still performing?
No, Dion Estes is the one that has replaced Thomas DeBarge. But also, sad to say, Tommy right now, his health is not doing that well. Matter of fact, when we did our Unsung episode, they actually shot some video with him, but they weren't able to use it. So if you look at that Unsung episode, you'll just kind of see pictures of him. But yeah, his health is not good right now. And him and I are the same age.
Okay. In fact, you all might want to take a look at that Unsung episode. It was very informative, and I thought I knew you, and I still learned some stuff.
Well, you do know me.
You know what?
Okay.
Don't take the bait. Don't take the bait.
I'm not following.
I'm gonna be fine. Okay. I'll be fine. Okay.
So listen, why don't you tell us, about the musical family that you come from? Just tell us whatever you want to tell us about your family.
Okay. Well, we were all born and raised in Akron, Ohio, and there's six of us. I'm the youngest of six. It goes from Henry, Joyce, James, Janice, David, and then myself. Now, all of us are musically inclined. My oldest brother, Henry, phenomenal piano player, phenomenal singer, and actually had a record deal with RCA Records, kind of like an Ashford and Simpson type thing. It was him and another girl. And, nothing happened with it, but he wasn't crazy about the music industry. So he went and got his master's degree in speech and hearing as a speech and hearing therapist. But he was, he probably of the musicians in the family, he's probably the most prolific. I mean, seriously, he's
really,
his ear was just so developed. So, you know, he was the oldest. Then my sister Joyce, she can sing, but she became a social worker. Then there was James. James got in his first band when he was 14. And that's how I got my interest. He used to take me around to rehearsals when I was 8 years old. But, you know, telling me not to touch nothing, you know, it's like, man, well, why'd you bring me? But I was so blown away. I'm like, I don't know how I'm going to do this, but I'm going to do this. And so James decided to do it for a living, and I decided. And then you have Janice, and she's done well with business. And then my brother, David, he actually played bass and could sing, but he was a sports guy. So he ended up playing baseball and everything. So, but James and I said, you know what, we're going to do this for a living. So,
okay. All right. Well, that, and first of all, I want to say, just hearing that you're the baby in the family explains so much about you. It explains so much, you know, just knowing you're the baby.
Hello. Sorry.
We couldn't hear you. I'm sorry. We couldn't hear you. I'm sorry.
Now, remember, I can mute y'all. Remember,
I know that's true. But anyway, so you kind of answered it. I was going to ask you, what was your aha moment when you knew that you were going to pursue a career in music, and obviously successful career, but what was your aha moment?
Well, this is interesting. I joined this band. The name of the band was called Raw Soul when I was 14 years old. I joined to be a percussionist because, it was a guitar player and the bass player, they lived across the street, and they were doing, you know, shows around town. And so I joined to be a percussionist, and it was actually the keyboard player that we had at the time. His name was George Anderson. He said, "Philip, do you know you can sing?" I'm like, "Well, yeah, I mean, I sing around the house and stuff." He said, "No, I mean, like, you need to come from behind those congos." I was like, "I don't know nothing about that." He said, "Well, you're going to learn."
Seriously,
so I got pushed out front. You know, bands back then, you knew they had the horns, and so we still did some instrumental stuff, but I literally got pushed out front with no experience singing "You Still a Young Man" at 14 years old. It's like, yeah, you best believe I'm still a young man. But yeah, that's how I got started. And then honestly, watching the band Jameson was in, Revelation Funk, and had this guy named Bernard Edwards I would watch. Like, I saw stuff he would do. And Howard Hewitt is also from Akron, and he was with a band called Life. So, you know, we would do different shows, and I was like, okay, I'm like, what he's doing? And I just picked up stuff. So by the time Switch got together, which was about 4 years later, you know, I already had this experience of how to be out front and perform. But yeah, I joined to be a percussionist. And he's like, no, you coming from behind them congos.
Awesome. I'm glad you did.
Yes, yes. Well,
I can still play the congos.
I was just about to say, and I'm glad to know that you play the congas, because, you know, I might need to hire you, you know, for one of my kids. Sometimes we be trying to do that little incognito stuff, and, you know, we need a little percussion in the.
Well, you remember that? Remember that song? Well, actually, I played percussion on our album stuff, but Edwin Starr had a hit called "Eye to Eye Contact." Remember the Anyway, the congos on the start, that's me. So.
Really?
Really? Yes.
It never stops the surprises with you.
No. We heard so much history doing the pre-conversation that you guys are going to miss so much, because we can only get so much in this short period of time.
Right. It's true. So you mentioned about, you know, you started out with another band, and then when Switch was formed. So let's talk about Switch's formation, how you got signed, and tell that whole story. It's very interesting to me.
Well, actually, I'm going to go back. Greg Williams, he was, this is how it developed. Greg Williams, Bobby DeBarge, and Tommy DeBarge, and Jody Sims were all part of a band called the TNT Flashers. Some of them are from Michigan, and some are from Ohio. And they end up forming a group, went out to California in the early 70s. Barry White saw them, liked them, signed them to RCA Records, changed their name to from TNT Flashers to White Heat. And so I had their album, and I was like, wow, you know, here's some guys from, because, you know, back then we had the Ohio Players, and basically them part were from Ohio, and it was like, we were excited. But then they came back, and they used Akron as almost like a basis between Michigan, and, you know, some of the players was in Ohio, and it's like, that's how we met. I was 16 years old. And so our band started doing shows for their band. And Greg Williams and I became, you know, good friends, me and Tommy and Bobby. And sad to say, Bobby at this time was having some other issues. So they got another guy named Arnie Haynes. So then we did Greg came to me and he said, hey man, I think White Heat has done all they can do. And so he talked to me about putting this group together. So Greg literally handpicked. He wanted guys that could sing, could play different instruments. And so that's how this got formed. Interestingly enough, when we did our demo, Bobby DeBarge was not part of the group. Arnie Haynes was. Arnie plays keyboards and sings falsetto and everything. And for some strange reason, well, let me back up. They, Greg Williams and Jody Sims fly out to California, and they were in the Motown building visiting the lawyer that helped them with their deal with RCA. They went to talk to him. When they left his office, they, you know, got on the elevator, and then on the 18th floor, the Motown building had, I think, 15 through 18. Jermaine Jackson walks onto the elevator. And you know how it is, when you see somebody famous, you kind of start humming, you know, kind of like, so they can go like, you can sing. They don't do nothing. But anyway, so he got off on the parking lot floor, and they got off, and they said, oh man, we should have gave him a tape. And I mean, a cassette tape. They only had one. They went back up on the fifth floor, ran, and Jermaine was sitting in his Rolls Royce. And at the time, you know, he lived in Thousand Oaks. So he was traveling from, you know, that's about a 40-minute drive from Hollywood out to Thousand Oaks.
Right.
He was looking for something to play. He saw them in the elevator. He said, may I help you? And they said, yeah, all we want you to do is just listen to our tape. He said, and he was kind enough to say, you know what? I'll listen to it on the way home. And so he did. And the next day, Hazel was in the hospital having Jermaine Jr. And he called the number on the tape, and it was Greg and them. He said, so what's happening? I mean, I'm loving everything I'm hearing. And Greg said, we don't have a deal. He said, are you kidding me? So he invited Greg and Jody up to the hospital, and we couldn't believe it. You know, we're still back in Akron, and Jermaine was interested, and that's how we got the interest in Motown. But they didn't hear Bobby DeBarge. They heard me and Arnie Haynes. Okay. And then once the deal was pending, to this day, I never found out why Arnie decided not to come. And we were like, are you kidding me?
What?
Yeah. So Greg, we had a band meeting. We were still in Akron. He says, Arnie's not coming. We're like, what do you mean he's not coming? And so we got mad, because it's like, you know, you want to blow this whole thing for us. He said, well, Bobby is clean right now. What do you guys think about Bobby? We loved Bobby's talent, but we know that he was volatile. And so, you know, and at the time, you know, you think, okay, once clean, always clean. But as you grow up, you're like, no, that ain't going to happen. But at least we said, yeah, let's do this. So Bobby actually flew out. We came out, and then Jermaine was literally hanging around us doing our stuff, and he heard, "I want to be with you." He heard, he's like, so, and remember, he was married to Hazel Gordy. So that was Barry Gordy.
Right, Barry's daughter, yeah.
Yes. So he said, "No, trust me, they need to be signed." So he comes back to us and says, "You guys got the deal." He said, "But they just need to see you, like Barry Gordy, Suzanne DePass, and them." We were like, "Are you serious?" So he said, "The deal is done." We're like, "Wow." So then we did the showcase with, you know, all these big wigs from Motown. And we just did what we normally do. You know, like I think I was telling you guys the other day, if I'm singing lead, Bobby was on the keyboards, Greg was on trumpet, Eddie was on the horns. Then Bobby would go up, I'd get on the keyboards. And then me and Bobby would go up and get a duet. And then Greg and Eddie would play the keyboards. You know, we had everything covered and all the harmonies and stuff. Then Bobby got on the drums. And long story short, Suzanne DePass, she said, "I have never seen so much switching in my life." And we just made a joke, like, why don't we call the band Switch? And Motown loved the idea because it really told who we were. Yes. Because we could all play multiple instruments and we sang like a singing group. Honestly, we're one of the only bands that I know of that was doing four-part harmony, you know, which is what singing groups do. So, yeah, it was very unique.
That's what I was going to ask you, was that fact or a myth? Because that is something I heard, that's how Switch got their name.
Yeah, that's exactly how we got our name. All of us play multiple instruments. All of the original, reason I'm laughing, because all of the original members, Akili, will be at rehearsal. He's like, "Man, I need a drumstick." And I'll be like, "You need to go down to KFC, because you ain't getting none of these." Because he, you know, like when he's out front, I'm playing the piano or something, then, but he doesn't play an instrument. It's like, oh, it's okay. But the rest of us do, so it's funny.
So how many instruments do you actually play, Phil?
Well, I started out when I was little with the drums. So, in like I said, I loved percussion. And then I got into keyboards. And then when I was 16, I went to the pawn shop and bought a bass. But I never learned to play the guitar. But, you know, so I can play the bass and keyboards and drums and percussion. But what happened, same thing happened to both James and myself. The singing became number one. So now for me, it's singing, keyboards, you mean, and then percussion stuff, because you can do a lot of that stuff, you know, on the keys. They got the sounds, they sound just like it, right. And it's so much easier. And then bass is now down on the bottom, but so now it's singing and keyboards are my main things now.
Okay, all right, very good. So what are, you know, I'm looking at, you know, the friends in the chatter, so they're so excited, and everybody's kind of had their own, you know, little experience with the group, but what are some songs that you have actually sung on, that most of us wouldn't know it was you?
Wait, you talking about with Switch or?
No.
Oh.
I mean.
You tell me, I mean.
Like you mentioned the other day, and I don't want to ruin it because that's part of what you're going to do later. So I'm not going to ask that. Never mind. Okay. I'm not going to ask that. So, but there are some songs. There are some songs that you...
I know Lynn looked like she's trying to cut you. I don't know what
happened. Did you see that? Did you see that?
I was going to say something, and then I changed my mind. But since you brought me in here, I'm going there anyway. Thank you very much. Before we go anywhere, we need to talk about that Switch hair.
Can we talk about the hair?
That iconic hair that I'm sure made Greg... What was his name? BG Guy?
Right, Barry Gibbs.
Barry Gibbs,
Phil, tell him what you said. You wasn't trying to be like Barry Gibbs.
Oh yeah, no, they used to say you look like a black Barry Gibbs. I said, no, he looks like a white Philip Ingram. I mean,
bam,
that part.
I love the Bee Gees, trust me, but I wasn't going for no Barry Gibbs look. That was just here's what happened. Motown, you know what? I wish I had that. See if I can pull this up. Motown did an album shoot on our first, a photo shoot, I meant to say, on our first album.
Okay.
Barry was like, this is not good enough. And so it's the exact same album, same music, everything. He had us all go to, because, you know, Motown was great for grooming bands. I mean, think about it. They took people from the projects and made them household names.
Right.
So they said, no, you guys need an image. They hooked us up with a clothes designer and everything. And then it's like, you know what? He needs to go to this hairdresser. I mean, seriously, And so they sent me to this hairdresser named Emery. Emery is the one who did my hair like that, and it became that look. But, you know, I had long hair, but he's the one that put it in that that mold. But,
Can we just see it? Can we just take a moment with the hair?
Yeah, I thought I sent that to you.
Oh, but I didn't know we were supposed to share it.
Oh, okay. Then hold up a second then. honey, I would have had all the stuff ready.
That's okay. I'm sure that anybody at home can pull up pictures of you and the hair. I'm pretty sure.
Oh, here. I got it right here.
We told you we was going to talk about the hair.
No, I know, but I sent it to you. I'm thinking you're going to do it, girl, please.
Okay. Well, I will say this. I did see some pictures of when you were younger, like 14 in the other band. And yes, the hair was magnificent.
It was happening.
So when you went to whomever that was that styled your hair, I half missed the name because someone was asking questions in the chat.
His name was Emery
did the world a wonderful favor because that picture was everywhere. And my sister's boyfriend loved it so much that he got his hair done. Okay.
You said he went and got his hair did?
Yeah, he got his hair did. Okay, yes, we get our hair done. He got his hair did.
Oh, it was so fun. Your hair should have collected royalties. can we all just take a moment and look at it's your hair is nice and soft and it's just you just need
there it is.
It was up there. So oh my goodness, it's like
let me tell you about this that particular picture. The photographer, the reason why that's so probably when you type in Philip Ingram, even though I've been a witness almost 40 years, but anyway, that picture is the one that comes up first. The photographer for that album shoot, he put a light behind the hair. So I'm like, man, what you trying to do? Give me a halo or something, you know? So that's why it has that little. And so anyway, that became like a famous.
Yeah.
But yeah.
It's a sharp picture. Somebody in the chat said they said Absalom. I'm leaving that alone. That's a new one, but it's so appropriate for that. Wow. You know, Absalom is somebody I'm trying to talk to in the new system. He's got a story. I'll be like, how you going to go get your daddy? But anyway, you know, his hair, the way the Bible describes him, he had beautiful, luxurious hair, right? So
it's funny. There was one time I did an interview, DJ, he said, I think I told you guys this the other day. He said, man, Philip bringing a cat with all the hair. And I was just joking. I said, man, look, I do sing. One day I'm going to be known for my singing.
No, it's both.
But we love the hair. So, of course, coming in the truth.
Right. We was going to get to that.
No, but I'm just saying.
Since you brought it up, why don't you tell us about the whole coming into the truth, how you came, how you got it, who introduced you? Did you accept it at first? Were you a hard case? just the whole.
So, yes. No, I was not a hard case at all. So here's what happened. Our first album was out. We were working on our second album. We were getting an award. I was 20 years old. You know, different people coming up asking me for an autograph. So this cute girl comes up. And let me just say this, first of all, it's not who I'm with right now. It's not Rebecca. So,
as I'm about to say, because Rebecca's real cute, so I ain't even mad at you. But go ahead.
Let me not put that out there. But anyway, she asked me for my autograph. I asked her for her number, and she was like, "Well, I don't give my number out to anybody." I'm like, "And you think I do?" So anyway, we exchanged numbers. So the next day, we're talking. The first words out of her mouth was, "I want you to know I'm one of Jehovah's Witnesses." I'm like, "Okay, I'm Pentecostal." I'm like, "Why is this girl telling me that she's one of Jehovah's Witnesses?" I'm like, this is different. So, okay, didn't know anything about Jehovah's Witnesses, didn't have any friends who were Jehovah's Witnesses, nothing. So she dated me, should she have? No. I'm grateful though, I got the truth from informally from her family. But somebody asked me the other day, what were you missing in your life? Absolutely nothing. Remember there's, in Jesus' illustration, you got the, you know, the man seeking fine pearls. Then you have the man in the field that stumbles across a fine pearl and recognizes its value. That was me. When the things that they were saying just made too much sense, and it wasn't one thing in particular, it was everything. I'm like, wow, Jehovah's Witnesses got the truth. So much so that me and Zane Giles, we were actually writing songs and stuff together. I didn't know that I was informally witnessing to him. And then finally I said, Jehovah's Witnesses got the truth. I said, I'm gonna start studying. Then he asked me to set up a study for him. And so that's how that came about. So my ex-wife, her and I got married. Mm-hmm. After I became a brother, I did, you know, matter of fact, when I studied, I wasn't studying to see whether this was the truth or not. I was studying to become a brother. And I'm like, okay, now I just got to work, figure out how to balance this music industry. So that's another story. But right. So we got married and, you know, we were doing good, started pioneering. I came to truth in 82, got baptized 82. We started pioneering together in September 84. We pioneered for 7 years. Then unfortunately, I ended up getting a scriptural divorce on her part. And then during that time period, I was really happy that, I mean, not happy that that happened. That's not what I'm saying. I'm happy that Jehovah allowed me to continue to, I was still serving as an elder and still serving as a pioneer. So it wasn't like they saw any fault, but I'm glad because it kept me busy. And also during that time period, because you know, your heart is broken. You know, divorce is hard. Yeah. And so you're going through all these different emotions, but I knew the truth. And then it's like also knew my old lifestyle where that had happened back then, you know, being like, but I ain't there. I got
right.
I love
right.
you.
Right.
So what happened, not only was I busy spiritually, which was the most important, but I was busy doing a whole bunch of sessions and stuff as well. And it's just almost like, you know, Jehovah knows what you need. And then I ended up going to the, it was a buddy that called me and he said, hey, Philip, you want to go to the international convention? I'm like, I mean, I heard the announcement, but my heart wasn't there. I'm like, sure. I mean, seriously, I wasn't there. And so he said, well, let me tell you the ones we put down. I said, okay. So I put them down. It was Rick and Barb Taylor. And, you know, they were, you know, so I had a lot of friends looking out. And so we end up getting that convention in Kiev, you know, and we were like, Kiev, okay. And so I remember when I got accepted, I was like, oh man, I wouldn't even, I mean, I literally mentally wasn't there, but Jehovah knew what I needed because that convention is a landmark convention. You know, they got 7,402 people that got baptized.
That's right.
I was there and it was like, wow, talking about. And so, and during that time period, you know, because it had been about 3 years, Rebecca and I had met and we had, were starting to, you know, develop a friendship. But that international convention was, you know, something like, wow. So Jehovah knew what I needed. And then after that, you know, Rebecca and I, we got married May 7th of 1994 after being single for about 3 years. And we just celebrated our 27th anniversary. And, you know, she's pioneering along with me as well. So that was a blessing where I never stopped pioneering. And I honestly, whenever you go through any type of tragedy, if you can keep your spiritual routine going as much as possible, that's what's going to help you through. And that's definitely what helped me.
So you started pioneering when?
1984, September
84. Wow, that is awesome. So clearly, you know, Jehovah's got your back.
And Coco, you ready for this? Can you believe they allowed me to conduct some pioneer schools? I've conducted seven.
Not you.
Seven pioneer schools with different circuit overseers. Can you believe I'm like, y'all sure y'all got the right person?
No, you wasn't the one I heard, you know, they was conducting pioneer school and the instructors had the pioneers up doing the electric slide during lunch.
No, you wasn't that one, right?
I'm crazy, but that ain't something you would have done. I'm telling you, that is something you would have done. I'm just saying, you didn't do it, but you know.
Just please.
That's a beautiful story. That is a beautiful, like it, you know, it just makes you have to take pause and just really appreciate how, you know, your journey that you've been on, both musically and, you know, spiritually. You're serving as an elder, you're a regular pioneer, can't nobody even get you, Harley, because you're giving talks all the time. You know, we trying to work it out, but you need a clone, basically. But anyway, that's a whole...
Oh, they like dirt a lot. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay.
Okay.
But I have to break this up.
Wait a minute, before you say that, I have to share this.
Okay.
Show you, because people ask me all the time about balance, right?
Yes.
You have to love Jehovah God a whole lot more than whatever it is in your life. If you love the music or the entertainment industry more than you love Jehovah, you will struggle. Yeah. So, you know, when Jesus asked Peter that question, do you love me more than these? I always ask people, what are the these in your life that you have to make sure that you love Jehovah more than whatever that these is?
Wow.
Mine was music. I still love music, but I had to put it in a matter of fact, when I was transitioning, it's like, okay, I get it. I can put Jehovah first. Okay, music second is fine. But then it's like, no, Philip, you don't understand. When you get married, your family comes second. I'm like, what you talking about, Willis? So I had to put Jehovah first, family second, and then music third. And it, okay. I mean, it didn't take me long, but once I found that balance, it's just, you know, Jehovah just works things out because you're doing things his way. But people ask me, how did I balance it? You got to love Jehovah more.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. I'm going to interrupt 1 second.
Why, here. Because you don't think you're going to get a turn because we have so much fun?
Well, that too, but I just want to speak to our friends. We see people putting up their hands. They're sending me private messages. They're putting a lot of things
in chat.
Someone just started to share. I would appreciate it. I know you all are really interested in a whole lot of things. We do have these same agendas that we are going to ask about. Hopefully he answers some of your questions. The interview is long from over, so be assured, 9 times out of 10, we're going to get where you want to go. Thank you.
We are going to get there.
We're not going to unmute you to let you ask a question. So hang on with the hand hold, raising and all of these wonderful things. We love you. He loves you. And we know you have an interest. But
just
hang in there with us. We'll probably get to where you want to be, or the questions you want to ask, okay?
But I do want to just say, Betty Hester wants to say hello to you. She said that she worked at Motown.
Betty and I mean, when I first got at Motown, she was one of the first people we met. Now, you know, I didn't know she was a witness. Found out later when she saw me one day at a convention, and that's when I was just starting to, you know, study and stuff, and I met her brother, Jonathan, and the whole family. Yeah, Betty and I went back from... I mean, Switch got signed in 1977.
Yes.
Yeah, 77. So I've known Betty since 77.
Yeah, she said she's known you for 40 years. I just wanted to make sure you knew that she was here. And,
hey,
and
Betty.
Jehovah has certainly blessed
you. Hear from you, definitely. Yeah,
your journey.
We go way back. Yeah. Okay. She was, it's funny, now being a witness, I recognize why, you know, she was so nice even back then. I didn't know she was a witness because I didn't know anything about Jehovah's Witnesses. Jody Sims, our drummer, he's also one of Jehovah's Witnesses.
Right.
And Llewellyn also became one of Jehovah's Witnesses. These are the original members. And like I mentioned, Zane Giles, he was our guitar player when we toured. So he's also one of Jehovah's Witnesses. So, you know, it was 6 of us on the album cover, 10 of us on stage because we had horn players. In fact, Gerald Albright was our sax player. Before he was a solo artist, he was on our horn section. We carried 3 horns, you know, we played live. But and Zane and I, you know, studied together. We got baptized together and everything. We've done a whole lot together. And then, so basically 4 out of that 10 that was on stage are in the truth. So
I mentioned
that as well.
That's amazing. Cool. I love it.
So tell us some of the songs that you wrote or recorded that you didn't think was going to be a hit, but turned out to be a really big song.
Well, the one that
I know it's hard for you to maybe think of one, but if, or maybe not.
Well, I mean, there's a lot of songs that I've sung on. And the reason why, you know, when you have a producer that's like a hot producer, when they get a sound and they, you know, you got a lot of people that's calling them, they use the same people. It's kind of like when Quincy was doing, you know, because I, you know, when James did that Just Once, I did that Dude tour with them as I was coming into Truth in 1982. But the band consisted of John Robinson on drums. John's played on all of you know, Quincy stuff. He had Louis Johnson on bass. You mean Greg Phil and Gaines?
Whoa.
So the same people that did the Thriller album, that did, you know, Quincy was producing a lot of people at that time. And so you tend to use the same people. So that's how I got on a lot of hits. I was working a lot with Walter Afanasieff. I know Preston knows him. They worked together. I actually met them together years ago doing a commercial up in San Francisco. Okay. And that's time I didn't know Preston and Gina was witnesses, but that's how we first met. And I met Walter. He was a keyboard player on that session. And then I was working a lot with Peter Wolf, and I was their vocal contractor. So, you know, they were hot. And so that's how I got to sing on a bunch of hit records.
Okay.
And also I was working with David Foster too. So like that song, what's that song? Because You Love Me by Celine Dion. I'm singing background on that.
Oh, yeah.
That Wang Chung, that everybody Wang Chung tonight. I'm singing
back. Is that you?
Oh, yeah. I Would Be Faithful by Go West. I will be faithful. Yeah. And then remember, what's the other one? I'm the king of wishful thinking. So now that was Peter Wolf. And okay. So, and then what's interesting, and my me and my brother James and Phil Perry, who's another phenomenal singer, we did so much stuff together that one of the records we did was, remember Boss Skaggs had this hit called Heart of Mine? That heart of mine, how do you keep on crying? Stop, grandma. It's a beautiful song. Bobby Caldwell wrote it.
Okay.
But it was me, James, and Phil Perry. And some of the, they would play the Boss Skaggs record. Some of the DJs would say, can you believe who's on background on this record? And they would mention me and James and Phil Perry's name. But yeah, it was a lot of hits, working with a lot of different people, especially in the 80s and 90s.
Yeah.
And then did a bunch of commercials. But as far as a songwriter, one of the ones, actually Ken Curry, I know he's on here.
Yes, was, he is.
He's a guy named Denzel Broadway Miller. He's another phenomenal keyboard player. He had a lot of hits and stuff. We said, let's get together and write a song. So he has this, you know, we got together, he had this little groove, and it was like, when I went over, this little 6/8 thing, I'm like, man, I love that. And I said, roll the tape. You mean? Yeah, I'm talking tape, just before we had digital stuff, like 1984.
Yeah.
And I said, Denzel, that's a hook. He said, nah, Phil, that's a verse. I said, Denzel, that's a hook. He said, no. I said, no, trust me, let's just, he played it. I sang this melody. And Ken and I had just met like a couple of years prior. And so he asked me about, could he try the lyrics on that song? I'm like, sure, you know. And I can't remember. I think we had done one before. There was a song that I did with Sherry Payne. It was a duet, yeah, called On and On. And Ken Curry and I wrote that one together. And so this song, it was like, okay, you know, we'll see. And so when he sent the lyrics back, we were like, yeah. So it was the song that Allison Williams recorded, Just Call My Name, that went to number 3 R&B.
So, you know, that's the jam.
Yeah, me, Denzel Miller, and Ken Curry wrote that one. And Ken, okay, and I, like I said, we wrote On and On, which was a single that Sherry Payne and I did for her, okay, record.
Okay. All right. So, go ahead, Lynn. Because, okay, you know, you just got to come in. Come on.
Yeah. I have like.
Someone's knocking at the door.
Okay. First, I want to say.
Please, yeah, don't let her come in. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm coming in.
I'm pushing my way in.
I'm messing with you.
First, I want to let you know that you and your wife have multiple congratulations on your wedding anniversary
from all the
friends in the chat. So I did let them know, everyone. There was two things I want to ask you about. I definitely want you to tell them about a lot of the soundtracks that you did for the movie, for many movies that you guys probably didn't even know he was singing on, and definitely the one I think everybody knows that they saw you in. But it was one song that you played for us when we were speaking previously that you and James and another person was singing falsetto on, that we were so shocked that it was you guys singing background. Yes, pull that up. They will be shocked.
Because when this came out, everybody thought it was women. One second.
Yes. Yes, I did. So
I did.
Right. When he told us and he played it for us, my mouth dropped because I'm going, that could not have been guys singing that.
Okay, wait one second. Let me pull it up.
Go ahead. Yeah, you're right. I'm just talking to people in the chat. They're like, we want to hear some more singing. Y'all go hear some more. Y'all go. We ain't hardly through with Phil.
So basically, I was telling them, I said, this is the highest song that we've ever recorded in my life. This one and me and this is me and my brother James and Phil Perry singing this, but me and Alex Brown and Daryl Fennessy, we sang Michael Paulo, the saxophone player, did a remake of That's the Way of the World. And so when we walked in, I said, Mike, did you put this up higher? He said, oh man, yeah, I forgot to tell you, it's still higher than the original record. I'm like, so that's another one. But anyway, this was a...
I would have loved to have heard that one.
Here, let me share the screen. And we are up in the stratosphere. And Lynn, who'd you say she looked like in this?
Who did Donna?
Wendy something.
Wendy Williams. Oh, yes. Yeah.
This is Donna Summer. Now, you know this back in the 80s.
You already know.
So there you go.
Okay. Yes. I thought that was women all these years until you played that for us. Can you guys believe it?
And Quincy produced that. That's James playing the keyboards now. Quincy produced that. And we were in the stratosphere on that one.
Who can sing higher, you or Phil Perry? Because,
well, you know what? Phil and I, falsetto is similar, but Phil's natural is a whole lot higher than mine.
Okay.
We used to be doing sessions. I'm like, man, shut that. I mean, now Phil, his natural is, you know, if you hear him on a, remember that song he did by, Aretha Franklin on his first album, Call Me. Oh man, his version, he's up
yes.
in, that's his natural, but
that's
his
one false, of my favorite songs.
Oh yeah, his false, we're similar. So like on that one,
yeah.
I don't even remember who did the top, me, James, or Phil, because we could all do it, you know what I mean? It's probably who felt they could hit it that day, but we're all up there.
Wow, that's amazing. Now, did I imagine this, or did we have a conversation years ago that you had something to do with the song, the Regina Bell, Peabo Bryson, A Whole New World. Did we have that conversation?
Yeah.
it just came to me the other day. I'm like,
I did the original demo for Beauty and the Beast.
Yeah.
And also for A Whole New World. And at the time, Walter Afanasio, he was the one that got to produce it. And Walter kept, you know, fighting for me to do it. He's like, you know, why we need to change singers? Because he loved, you know, basically what I did. It was me and a girl named Susie Benson. I'm sorry, me and Sally Dworsky that did Beauty and the Beast. Susie Benson and I did A Whole New World. And it was interesting when you work with different people. But they, you know, I forgot about that. James and what's the name? Linda Ronstadt had that song out somewhere out there.
Right.
So DreamWorks beat Disney having, you know, major artists singing a song. So basically James and Linda was first on Somewhere Out There, you know what I mean? So then Disney's like, ah. So when they did that, you know, and at the time I wasn't, you know, I was more behind the scenes. And so they wanted more of a name, but, and Walter was like, nah, man. So here's what's interesting. I worked a lot with David Pack, the guy from Ambrosia. And I did a bunch of sessions with him. So one day, and this is when people that work with you, he said, Philip, did you do the demo for Beauty and Beast? I was like, yeah, how'd you know that? Because we worked together so much. He said, it just sounds like you. And then when I was doing my best friend's wedding, Bonnie Greenberg, she was the musical director. We leave the set going back to the hotel and a whole new world comes on. She said, Philip, is that you or your brother? I said, that's Peebo Bryson. She said, that's Peebo? And she said, that sound like you. I'm like, oh, I did the demo. She's right. Like, oh, okay. Because people in the industry, they understand that. So
Yeah. That conversation, I don't know why we were talking, like, you know, what we were talking about, but somehow I remembered you, you know, telling me about that. So Lynn, you wanted to ask about he and his brother.
I did. I was just reading some comments in the.
I know.
Yeah, and they're asking a whole lot of things, but
we gonna get to it.
Yeah, we're gonna get to it. I promise you. We have people asking about software programs. Someone's asking how to get in touch with you. TMO is asking how to get in touch with you, and they know that it's an associated cost for.
Yeah, they know it ain't free. You know,
all sorts of things. So, but yeah. My question had to do with your brother. You kind of answered some of that, which was, yeah, you guys performed together. You did background songs together and so forth. But whose career really took off first, yours or his?
Well, yeah. Well, ours. Switch did. This is what was so funny. James left when he was 20 years old. I was 14. He sees me just getting into my first band. And then, you know, he would come back and visit and stuff. And the band he went out there with, Revelation Funk, they ended up, you know, leaving, women. See if I pull up that picture. They end up leaving, and James was like, okay, I'm sorry. I'm staying out here. I think I got this one. Raw Soul, Revelation Funk, where is it? Huh, I thought I had it in here. Okay, I don't have it. All right, anyway, so, you know, like I told you a story about them coming out. So I'm 18 years old. Remember, James, he wasn't known yet as a solo artist, but he was out there hustling. And so here's how the conversation went. I said, hey, James, I'm coming out to California. He said, for what? First of all, I'm like, what? I can't come to California? He said, no, man. I said, our group got a deal. He like, what do you mean you got a deal? Because, you know, I'm back in Akron.
Right.
James, I said, Greg and Jody went to California. They ran into Jermaine Jackson. They gave him a tape. He said, Philip, are you serious? I'm like, James, yes. I'm trying to tell you. He's like, oh, man, that's slick. So James was very supportive. He was very proud. So, you know, our first album came out and did what it did in the second album. And during our second album, that's when James started doing some work. It was interesting. James had sang the demo for three songs. He was doing a lot of, James was a hustler. He was singing demos for Barry Mann and Cynthia Wilde. They were the ones that wrote Just Once. He did Just Once, that Never Gonna Let You Go, that ended up with Sergio Mendez, and a song called Here and Now that Bill Medley recorded, that we sang background on that. Okay. But that song got sent to Quincy, and Quincy said, man, I love the song and I love the singer. He didn't use the other two, but he said Just Once was huge. So when I came off the road, you know, actually, James, I had a new car. I had James keep my car. He was like, I'm just driving this new car down the studio, singing this stuff, right? So I go to pick up my car, and he says, hey, man, I got to play you something. And he played me Just Once, and I was like, done. You over. That's done. And so, but here's the funny part. James was a keyboard player. He was not an out front person like I was. So he had no idea how to be out front. He said, man, can you believe this? Quincy wants me to go to Japan with him to sing, to be out front. I'm like, what you gonna do? Because he had never done it. I don't know, I'm gonna make up something. But he was, you know, he got used to it, but in the beginning. So that's why if you look at his old videos, he would be on the keyboards playing in the beginning and singing, and then he would kind of get up and go out front because he had never been out front. And so, and then he became, you know, a solo artist, but yeah. So Switch hit first, proud of him. I mean, he was proud of me and I was proud of him, but we were proud of each other. Here's what's sad though, because we're brothers, people compare us. It's like James and I never compared each other. We just respected each other's talents.
That's what I was just thinking, that how awesome that is that there was no sibling rivalry, you know, no competition. Oh, I gotta outdo you, but you guys had mutual respect for each other. What I love about James and you is you both, although there's some similarities, but you both have your own sound. Like when we hear you, We know it's Phil Ingram. Like, we don't mistake you, right, you know, right, for these other cookie cutter artists that are out here. And the same thing with James. When you heard Just Once or
you knew it
Find One, or... what is Find 1 Million Ways or Find 100 Ways?
Yeah, 100
you know, ways. I'm trying to, you know, enhance it.
you hear that, Mike? No, I'm teasing. Okay. You
know, I'm trying to get mine in. Oh, that's Will Downing who does 1 Million Ways. Okay, so James does Find 100 Ways.
Right.
But when we hear that, we know who it is. Right. And that always is so awesome to me when you hear somebody's voice and you're like, oh, that's so-and-so. Right. You know, that's not the norm in the music business today. And so,
Did you and your brother ever record together a song? I don't recall ever hearing one. Did you ever record together?
We had two separate careers because, you know, like I said, 6 years apart. We did a lot of commercials together. We did a lot of films and stuff and a lot of songs. Matter of fact, I was calling him because I was doing a lot of contracting, like I said. And one day, this was after James had, you know, his first album and the success. Well, it wasn't actually his first album. It was Quincy's album where he was a guest vocal, you know, with Just Once. He sang Just Once, The Dude, and 100 Ways. Mm-hmm. But he was getting all this stuff happening. So we were doing a lot of sessions. So one day he called me, he said, Philip, you know, I love singing with you. He said, but he said, I got to get my albums done. So I said, you don't want me to call you? He said, no, you can call me later. But I said, okay. But we did a lot of stuff together. But no, we never recorded like a duet. But I did, you know, do some shows with him where I did Michael McDonald's part, you know, and Y'all Will Be There a couple of times.
Okay. And what year did James pass away?
2019, January 2019. Okay. And December 2018, we lost my brother David. So back to back, they both had health issues, but we knew that something was going to happen. We just wasn't expecting it to be back to back. So a month apart.
That had to be hard. How wonderful, you know, that you had the truth and were in the truth and could hold on and share some music in the future with your brother. You never know. That's going to be pretty cool to be able to do that. So.
Yeah, but you had your own health issues. You want to tell us about that?
Well, yeah, it's funny that you, it was not funny, but my two sisters, because, you know, think about it. They lost David in December 2018, James in 2019. And then, you know, it's left four of us. And then, you know, I had, you know, quite a few shows. I'd been in Singapore, I was in the Philippines. And a week before this, that's why this has always been amazing to me. You know, Jehovah's Hand was this. I was in Santiago, Chile. And then the plane even gets stuck and we get home a day later. Supposed to get home on September 8th, got home on September 9th. We had our meeting that Wednesday, that Thursday, the 12th, 13th, left to go to Atlanta with Switch. We had a show in Atlanta on the 14th, and it was a sold out show. And I wake up, I felt great. I ate breakfast, and after that, I'm like, ooh, something's wrong. I don't know what was wrong. Long story short, I end up going to urgent care. He said, you need to go to the hospital. He says, you're a black male over 50. And they ran the vitals, and then they were actually going to do this procedure on Monday, but then they found a portion of the heart that wasn't moving. They said, we need to call the cardiologist team in. So Switch had to do the show without me, but actually they did a procedure where they went through the wrist. They didn't cut open the chest or anything. And when he got done, because they had to explore to see what it was, he said, Mr. Ingham, do you know you just had a heart attack? Like, I said, what are you talking about, Willis? No, I didn't say that. I said, are you serious? He said, yes. This will blow me away. He said, you had one artery that was 100% blocked. We put a stent in it. And in my mind, I'm like, a week before that, I was in Santiago, Chile.
Wow.
On the plane for 30 hours in another country.
Not where you want to get caught.
No, but I'm back here. So I'm like, what was it, 98.6 when I was in, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I get back to the United States and get this. I get, you know, and then they did the other procedure on that Monday. Rebecca came out that Sunday. But, you know, I was only in the hospital till that Tuesday. But I had to stay in Atlanta. And we stayed with some friends.
Yeah.
Because they said if you fly, you could develop blood clots. So right. The PVG brother, his name was Paul, him and I became friends. He said, Philip, since you're going to be out to hospital, would you like to come over to the house on Friday? I said, love to, as long as you don't give me no ribs. Saturday, I'm done. I'm done, man. And he was like, he said, yeah, we'll hook you up. So his wife is an x-ray technician. So she says, so Philip, who did you have as your doctor? I said, we had Dr. Lieberman. She says, are you kidding me? I'm like, no. She says, Philip, he's like the number one cardiologist in all Atlanta. She said, people wait for months for Dr. Lieberman. Her name was, I said, Paula, come on, girl. We got the same dad. I mean, we got the same father.
How about that?
But wow. I didn't know that until she told me that. So,
yeah. No,
Jehovah was definitely, his hand was all in that. I mean, it was wonderful. And just so you know, I mean, I think, Coco, you've known me, but I've dropped the weight and everything. I've done everything I'm supposed to do. Last checkup was beginning of May, and that was my goal, to have everything in a healthy place, and that's where I'm at.
Yeah. So. Yeah. Well, good. Well, we're glad you're here, and you're in full form today. So you clearly have recovered, and we are. I remember I was at an anniversary party when somebody sent me a text. That, you know, what happened. I'm like, what? That messed up my night. I just want you to know, you messed up my night, but I'm glad you know.
I didn't send you the text, girl. Somebody else did.
but I'm glad that you pulled through. Let's get back to the music, and then we're going to get to the music in just a few minutes. But just how do you keep it balanced? There's a lot of, you know, some people have asked, there's a lot of young folks who kind of would love to get into the music business. There are some older ones who it held them back from getting into the music because they didn't think you could do both, you know? So what's your words of advice for maybe young ones who are thinking about getting into it? What would you tell them?
Well, see, I touched on it earlier.
You did. Yeah.
When you love Jehovah more than these, right? If you think of it that way, so, two scriptures that I use as my guideline. What does Matthew 6:33 say? Seek first the kingdom. Mm-hmm. All these other things, right? They're going to be added. The necessities of life. So, and that takes faith. Jehovah's going to, you know, take care of you. Malachi 3:10 also says to test him out in this respect and see whether I will not, you know, open to you the floodgates of the heaven.
Right.
So the point is, doing these things, I didn't miss meetings. So here's like when I was trying to find my balance, I was getting calls from these big names in the industry. And, you know, they always want to do a session on a meeting night.
Yeah, of course.
That's when Satan wants you to do it.
Of course.
And so sometimes you will give up that opportunity. You'll miss a meeting. Like, well, I can make that up, you know, so you can. But I'm like, I don't get that's the sense of Malachi 3:10. So I was turning down these big names. I said, actually, I have an appointment. And but one, I think I told you, was Burt Bacharach when he called me. Because like I said, I was doing a bunch of stuff. And he was producing and wanted me to put a background session together. And then I was like, sure. And it was a Monday night at 7. And I had a Monday night book study. I said, Burt, I love your music. Loved you for years. I look forward to working with you, but I'm not going to be able to do it. Right? And just.
Wow. And like, just, who tells Burt Bacharach no?
Jehovah God.
I know. That's probably what he was thinking. Like, do you know who I am?
But I just said, you know what? I'm like, okay, Jehovah, I'm testing you out in this regard. So a month later, and this is what blew me away. And that's when I start seeing, just let Jehovah work things out. When he didn't call me back, his assistant. And the question was, Philip, Bert is doing, I forgot who it was, either Dionne Warwick or Gladys Knight, but he said, Bert wants to know which evening works better for you, Monday night or Tuesday night.
There you go.
I said, Tuesday would be fine. And I end up working with him about 8 or 9 years. And I tell people it was on my terms, but my terms was Jehovah's. So if he said, can you, I'm like, no. And a lot of times, you know, especially with sessions, you can have a guitar player come in and do a background session another day, that type of thing.
Right.
The biggest thing I sacrificed, which was I couldn't see how to balance that, was the touring, you know, going like months at a time. I've still traveled around the world, but not gone for like months at a time. So that was, that's the biggest thing I gave up. And I love to perform. So,
and
Jehovah takes care of us. I mean, because think about it, since this pandemic, I did it. Last session I did was in February of 2020. Pepe Aguilar is a Latin artist.
Uh-huh.
That's the last time I worked.
Wow.
And here we are.
You ain't missed a beat.
You're here to work for us tonight.
Yes.
What'd you say, Lynn?
I said, you're here to work for us tonight. So,
yes.
But we're going to get to that in a minute.
What, for free 99? Please,
thank
girl.
Thank you.
I told you I would cash app you. I told you I would cash app you $10. I told you that.
Look, I got two on it.
She got two on it. But just one quick question before we get to the live portion of the show. I want to talk about your original music.
This ain't live? You think this is
pretty? No. She wanted to ask you something about something else, but go ahead and ask your question. Then
Your songs that are on your website.
Oh, yeah.
Wait, last Saturday, we were both at this beautiful wedding on Zoom. And then when the bride and groom started dancing, I was like, well, what song is that? I'm texting Phil during the dance. Dude, is this you? How can I get this song? I bought it and downloaded it before they was finished dancing. It's called Most of All. It is a beautiful song. When he gives you his website of where you can find his music later, y'all need to go buy that song and all the other songs that's up there too. That is some good, good music up there. So,
well, thank you. You can keep the 10 that you're going to give me.
Oh, okay. All right. Okay. I'll keep that. What's your favorite song that you've written, you know, that's on your site?
Actually, Damaged Goods.
Damaged Goods.
Rex Salas and I wrote that, and he had this beautiful melody, and he gave it to me. He said, this sounds like, you know, like an Ingram type thing. And him and I, it's funny, I was looking at my kindergarten picture, and I just said, boy, so innocent, so sweet. And then I started writing these lyrics. And then I remember when I got done, you know, because all of us are damaged goods. I mean, you know, it's like that talk. What's that talk? Moselle Matt gives it stay at Jehovah's table. Okay. And, you know, where he says, you know, all of us have been dropped on our heads. You know what I mean?
Yeah. So,
in other words, so a lot of us are damaged goods. And every time I perform that, when I tell the story, people are crying because we're all damaged goods in one way or another. So when I first told Rex about it, because Rex and I did a whole bunch of things prior to, you know, him and I both in the music industry prior to coming into Truth.
Yes.
And that's another story. But
yeah,
I called him up and I said, man, I got this idea about damaged goods. He's like, no, man, I said, Rex, here, let me do it. Let me just write the lyrics, sing it out. If you don't like it, come on, man, we can write another lyric. He said, okay. So at that time he was living in West Hills, and now he's down like in a Inland Empire, but it was so funny. So I played it for him over the phone. He said, hey, man, I'm gonna be over in about 5 minutes to get my copy. But okay. The lyrics on that are so meaningful.
Okay, I'm gonna take a listen tonight, and I may, you know, spend another few dollars and get that song. Cause you know, even though you're my friend, I don't expect you to give me the music for free. I'm gonna buy your songs. So I have one last question.
Lady Coca, I'd give it to you, but go ahead. Go ahead.
You can refund me for the song I bought last Saturday, but that's okay. I have one last question.
Okay.
What would Phil Ingram, 2021, tell Phil Ingram in 1976 if you could backtrack and ask and tell young Phil something? What would you tell him?
Excellent.
Oh, girl, please, that was no excellent question.
Good question. That is an excellent question. Because everybody wants
that's
to
That's because he's trying to think of the answer. He's trying to think of the answer right
I know,
now.
Stall tactics, whatever.
Oh, I have one more question after
No,
that.
No, I got a question before you.
Yeah, no, you got it. You got it, Lynn. But
no,
he got to perform. So.
Yes, he does.
There's two things. Because musically, honestly, I would say the same thing that was told to me from my parents musically. Because people say, like, when Switch hit, did you wig out? It's like, absolutely not. Because Henry Ingram and Alistine Ingram, they were very proud of their sons. But trust me, when I'd go back to visit, my father would be having me taken out the trash. I mean, he was happy. I got a platinum album. That's great. Yeah, but Philip, you know. So that part was the same. But being knowing nothing about Jehovah's Witnesses and knowing, again, like I said, being this man in the field that stumbled across this and recognizing its value, it's like, yeah, if I had learned that earlier, you probably would have never known about Switch, seriously. But because I got the Truth in 82, 76, oddly enough, is the year that Switch got together.
Wow. So, yeah.
But been very grateful that I had that, and then coming into Truth, and then being able to do the things that I have been able to do, but balance it by, you know, making sure that I'm serving Jehovah first. Yeah. You mean?
Yeah.
And that's the key in any profession, I would think, if you are a witness, because of the many years that I had to work too with all the strange schedules that I had, it had to be focused on Jehovah.
Yeah.
Otherwise, I wouldn't have gotten through it. And I'm sure you guys in the entertainment industry, all of our friends, just about everyone who has come on that's in entertainment business has said basically the same thing, that they had to make Jehovah the priority and the music second. And that is commendable, because I can see where it would take over your life if you didn't.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Matter of fact, I've actually had people, you know, like, especially when I went through my divorce, I was doing a lot of writing and stuff. And they were like, man, I've even had people say, but if I had your voice, I honestly don't know if I'd be in the Truth. I'm like,
wow.
But yeah, but that's what some people are. You know, I've worked with quite a bit that had some hit records. You know, I'm not going to give them names right now, but that's inactive because they got a hit record. I've worked with quite a few.
So. Right. Right. Okay.
So I know Lady Coco got other questions she want to ask, and she got serious questions. But
that's fine. No,
because mine is a silly question. Go ahead.
Okay. What is your latest project, Phil, that you're working on?
Well, right now, the only thing that we have going, Switch, like I said, we're going to be doing some more of those At Home at Switch series. And we also have, we have another song that we've done as a group. But then there's also been some people that's approached us about doing some other things. So right now it's like, yeah, we got to make sure that's right. But if that happens, you know, we'll be doing some more recording. Because the cool thing is, honestly, even with this, we all have, you know, recording studios and stuff at the house. So it's, you know, it's now you can just send the file and,
right.
You know, especially during this pandemic.
Right.
You know, I do that a lot where I'm singing backgrounds. Matter of fact, I have a duet out with a lady named Sonia Eddings Brown that we did. She was on FaceTime, and it's a duet for something for the Olympics, for the swim team.
Okay. Oh, nice.
Okay.
I forgot about that. So yeah, that's a beautiful song. But you know, I sang it from here, you know, and she sang hers from wherever she sang it and sent me the files. And
That's so nice.
Okay.
So go ahead, Lynn.
Okay, so I'm going to run all mine together since Lady Coco wanted to ask 20 questions and wouldn't let me in. I'm joking. I'm joking. Relax. I'm joking. I really am joking. Okay, so the first one is, tell me a fun fact about yourself. Since you're a talented guy, tell me your strangest talent. And the last one here, if you had one song to listen to the rest of your life, what would that be? And that's the only one song. No other song, just that one song. Okay, go.
You mean one song that'll drive you crazy?
Well, no, that's the only song that you could listen to. It probably would drive you crazy after a while, but it's just that one song that you would listen to, and that's the only song you could ever hear again.
Okay, so first of all, a fun fact about myself, obviously you can tell I'm crazy. So I think I told you when we were doing the little sound check, you know, we grew up, you know, especially Akron, Ohio, they call it playing the dozen, you know, bagging on each other.
Yeah.
And so I can dish it. I can take it. You can talk about me. And, you know, they say don't talk about you. You can talk about my mama because I'm going to talk about yours, too. But anyway, you know, teasingly. But it was just one time, you know, those people that didn't know me, it was interesting that this actually, I got two now. You made me think of something else. But anyway, this one girl, you know, I was really nice to some fans. You know, this was after we were doing some shows and stuff. This was Switch back in the heyday. And it was about five, and it was like two guys and three girls, and I invited them up to the room. They're talking. So this one girl kept bagging on me. I'm like, okay, honey, if she gonna bag on me, I'm thinking she can take it. So I'm like hitting her back, and they were like, ooh, man, you know, Philip Ingham. And it's like, because they didn't know me. They're just, you know, you look at an album cover, you think you know a person. It's like, honey. You know, it's like don't ever try to say something to a comedian when he has a mic. Yep. Ooh, honey, right? So did it again. So the third time, she started crying. And I felt bad. I'm like, wait a minute. Honey, you come to my room. You're the one bringing this. And now you're crying. What's up? And they were like, so I went and gave her a hug. I'm like, she probably did that. So I gave her a hug. No, I'm teasing. But anyway, that was a fun fact. But I will tell you this one. I'm sorry. We have what we call DeBarge isms.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
We were on the elevator with Suzanne DePass, you know, one of our Motown meetings. And Bobby, I love you, but Bobby, no, hey, I'm sorry. I lost it. You know, sometimes if you can't say the right word, just say, Suzanne, you smell nice. Bobby said, wow, Suzanne, that's a nice fragment you're wearing. I lost it. I said, it's fragrance. And I said, man, just say she smelled nice. And we have these barge-isms. And here's the last one, fun fact.
Okay.
We come from this meeting. It was the whole band, right? And this girl was, and this is way pre-American Idol. This girl was in the lobby of the Motown building. She's like, switch, switch. And we, you know, we're nice and stuff. And so we go up and meet her and we give her an autograph and stuff. So then she says she can sing. We're like, okay, but we didn't ask her to sing. So she starts singing, and I still remember what she was singing. She was singing, If I'm Your Woman, and she was like, If I Was Your Woman. And Tommy DeBarge did just what Lady Coco did. She lost it. And I was like, I felt so bad for her. And then she started crying. Then she got all mad, and she said, Well, honey, y'all don't look like y'all album covers. And then I said, Then how did you know who we were? And then the band lost it. So anyway.
Anyway, Phil Ingram, okay, y'all. Phil Ingram, y'all.
What's the song? The one song?
Well, oh, yeah, the one song you could listen to.
Well, I will tell you the song for me that changed my life that I said when I was 13 years old that I said, I'm going to, because I went to the school. People say, man, where did you learn to sing? I went to the school of Stevie Wonder and Donny Hathaway. So much so that when we did our first album, you know, I'm 18 years old. You know, you don't like Lady Coco, when you mentioned about having a style.
Uh-huh.
When I was 18, I didn't. You mean, I didn't have that identity because you just, you know, you do in top 40.
Right.
I was into Stevie so much so one day we were doing a record. Jermaine Jackson stopped the tape and said, Philip, three words that changed my life. He said, Philip, no, four, Philip, Stevie got his. I was 18, had no idea who Philip Ingram was. And I had to develop Philip Ingram.
Yes.
Hazel actually helped me. She doesn't know this, but she said when Michael, when they were, you know, they were up and coming, she said sometimes producers would, you know, give them certain lines and stuff. And she said Michael would do his own thing. And I was like, huh. So I started, when she said that, she was just a conversation. So I started doing it, started trying stuff, which helped me develop Philip. The song that changed me, I was 13 years old. First time I heard Mary Wants to Be a Superwoman by Stevie Wonder. Do you know, 62, and I still get chills when I play that.
Because that was a great song.
Oh, man. I mean, the music. We're just starting to hear the keyboard basses. I'm like, the harmonies. I was just like, I mean, chills.
Yeah.
So I'd have to say, I don't get tired of Mary Wants to Be a Superwoman.
Okay.
That's a great part two.
You know, okay. When the summer came, you were not around. I was like, sing, boy, sing! I mean, it's like...
Look, speaking of sing, boy, sing, it's time for you to sing, boy, sing.
I know everybody's like, they're going to finally
sing. Everybody's waiting. They're like, I know he's going to sing some. So y'all know we wouldn't do that to you. You know we wouldn't do that to you. Come on. So now we're just going to let you run amok, which is what you've been doing anyway. You can sing, you know, at least two songs, but if you feel like doing another one, ain't nobody gonna say nothing. So can we turn the stage over to Brother Philip Ingram, y'all?
Well, you already did, but okay.
I mean, we gonna leave. It's just gonna be about you.
Okay, then let me tell you about this song then. This song is you heard me mention Rex Salas.
Yes.
So Rex, you know, he was Janet Jackson's musical director. He's worked with a lot of people. Jasmine Guy. Oh, that's another one I didn't put on the list.
The list.
Yeah. Rex and I did a lot of stuff in the music industry before, you know, coming to Truth. So one day he calls me up and I thought he was calling me for a session because we did a lot of stuff together. And he said, Philip, that's because, you know, after coming off the road with Janet, he had played her a song. And at the time, her nieces, Stacy and Yashi, they had a little thing. She said, I think that'd be a nice thing for them. And so he was working with them, but they would always leave and go to the meetings and stuff. And he said, that same old mess Philip would be doing, right? So one day he calls me, and I'm like, I still remember it was on a Saturday, and my mouth was wide open. Like, he said, "Hey, man, I just want to let you know I went to the Kingdom Hall." I'm like, "What do you mean you went to the Kingdom Hall?" He said, "Well, Stacy and them invited me." I said, "Are you serious?" And then he said this, "I know Jehovah's Witnesses have the truth." I'm like, "Rex, are you serious?" He was like, "Yeah." He said, "But I want to study with you because I know that you," I said, "You got it." And the very next day I was giving a talk in the Oak Nose congregation. And I remember me and Rick Taylor was up talking, and, you know, Rex pulls up in his Porsche, got hair down to here. And Rick was like, "That's the study." I said, "Yeah, he's mine." So, but we started studying. It was the knowledge book. And, you know, he was making good progress and stuff. And then one day we finished the study and he said, "Philip, I have this song." Matter of fact, Preston, I'm sure you remember this. I sang it at Mira Loma when they had that thing.
Yes.
Gorgeous song.
It's gorgeous.
Said, "I wrote this song, but I want you to sing it. It's called You Made Room for Me." And I'm like, "Man, I love it." And so he played it for me. I'm like, so I'll sing that song. And that's
all right.
Rex Salas, You Made Room for Me. So listen to the lyrics.
The spotlight is all yours.
Well, let me cut this out. But you can, if you're not hearing it well enough, please let me know. Can you hear that? Oh. So listen to the lyrics. Just when I thought that I had everything, there's so much more I needed to know. I'm learning just what it is to seek Him first. That's all I want to do. Doing the righteous thing, I'll keep on the road to everlasting life. Now that I've opened my eyes and want Your will, that's when You showed me paradise. How can I forget the things Jehovah's done for me? You gave Your Son who died for us so we could all be free. The more I seek, the more I know, by faith I do believe. And all this time I've waited, the truth now I do see. You opened up the door and made room for me. Oh, You did. And all this time I've waited, all the truth now I do see. You opened up the door and made room for me. Ooh. You made room.
Next.
What, can the brother, what you think of the song, girl? Please, like, come on.
Oh, I'm sorry. That is beautiful.
So that's written by Rex.
I love those lyrics. I'm sure that it's something we can all relate to. You know, Jehovah had to make room for all of us. That is a gorgeous song. Gorgeous song.
Well, thank you, Lady Coco. And Lynn, you come back in to say what?
Lynn, don't.
Okay, Painty.
Hi. I came back to say that I enjoyed
that. Okay. That was really beautiful. Seriously.
It was. Okay.
Well, this one is a
next
classic. I like this one because this is, you know, we all had songs that we wish we had have written. When I first heard this song, I'm like, boy, what a gorgeous song. It's the Bonnie Raitt song, I Can't Make You Love Me. And I remember when I said, I'm going to do an arrangement of this. I had performed this with Ronnie Laws, him and I at Leoness Winery. And everybody kept saying, you need to make that in a record. Anyway, I love the song. I love the melody and everything. So I said, I'm going to put my own spin on it. So when I was sitting up here, I did this track, and I want a little different intro. And I found this thing, you can hear these gorgeous strings. I said, whoa. And it was in the same key of the song that I was doing. And I was like, it's not the LA Philharmonic, even though I live in LA and my name is Phil and I sing harmonies. But anyway, the point is, this is my version of I Can't Make You Love Me. And it's one of my favorite songs. Let me see. I should have it. Where's it at? Oh, here it is. Okay. Randy Henderson is on the sax. Just me and Randy. Ingram.
No, if you
you don't know, no matter how much I try, no, no. I can make your heart feel, oh, something it won't. Here in the dark, in these final hours, I'm gonna lay down my heart, and I feel the power, baby. Oh, you don't, no, you don't, you never did, you never will, no matter what I do, no matter what I do, no, 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 cause I can't make you love me, baby, 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 no matter how much I try. I can try every day and every night, trying to send you little messages on the phone. Oh, never hear back from you, never send you at home. Don't matter what I do, and every time I try to make a deal, I can't tell you I'm trying to love you, baby. Would you tell me? You can't tell me, baby. Cause I can't make you, no, 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 no. I can't make you love me, no, 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 no. Cause I can't make you love me if you don't. No, no, no.
Aww. Thank you.
Oh.
That was wonderful.
Well, thank you.
Thank you. Okay.
You okay? You okay, yeah. Lynn?
She's right. Not, I'm not.
I am not okay.
She not okay, but I am.
Because that that is one of my absolute favorite songs of all time to listen to perform. Dude, I need that track. You need to just email me. I got five on it. I need that track.
This has been the Philip Ingram arrangement.
Oh, it's like that.
When I had Randy playing the sax, I don't know if Randy's here or not, but I said, Randy, I said, man, just play some random stuff.
Yeah.
And he wasn't, I said, Randy, just trust me. Because I wanted to have like a live feel, you know, you breaking down and, you know.
Right, yeah, you know, it's beautiful.
I said, just do some stuff. So when he saw, I think, Coco, you were there when we did that show at the, in Canoga Park.
Yes.
And I did this, and then when Randy called me next day, he said, because I was singing in between as if we on stage together, but I'm up there by myself. And so,
right.
Yeah. But no, he did a great job. So yeah, that's.
Right. That was awesome. And for those of you who don't know what Randy he's referring to, it's Randy Henderson, who is the son of Wayne Henderson, who's one of the original founding members of the Jazz Crusaders.
Thank you. So, I'm sorry.
Yeah. And Randy is like, he's not usually the one who's out front. So that was awesome that you.
Oh, Randy. Yeah. He.
Man, that you got that out of him.
But I've done a lot of stuff together as well. We've written stuff.
Yeah. You know, when you're a name dropper, you just think everybody knows who you're talking about. You know what I'm saying? You know, just Randy.
You know, Randy.
Hazel. Yeah, all these, we know all these people. They're our personal friends.
Oh, excuse me. Next time, I will have a little caveat before I say the name.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Y'all heard it here. He did say next time, because we may have to revisit you, Phil Ingram.
I think we do. But
you may have to revisit.
Unfortunately, well, we've not reached that time.
If so, the price gonna go up, but that's a whole nother open.
Oh, look.
25. I cash app you 25. I already got you.
I still got two on it.
We got you, bro. We gonna cover your expenses. We got you. can you share quickly where individuals can find your information? You know, where they can find your music, where they can, you know, keep up with where you're at and what you're doing.
Yes.
Is the information that you gave us the other day valid? Is that what you would want them to contact you on?
Yeah, it's that way. One second.
Oh, because Lynn, you had that. Yeah.
I did take a screenshot. I could fake like I got it.
I got it.
He got it. So you all can take a picture of this, or, you know, I'll put it in the chat at some, you know, during the evening if you want to. Do you have like a mailing list, Phil?
Yes.
Okay.
So here.
All of that, and that way you can know all things Phil Ingram.
See, under there it says www.philipingram.org. If you go there, it says join the mailing list. It'll pop up and you can just do that. You can subscribe to the Philip Ingram channel. I put up, you know, videos and stuff up there.
Yeah.
There, that channel is into playlist.
Mm-hmm.
Excuse me. You know, with guest vocals that I've done, with things where I'm playing on that I'm not even singing. Because a lot of people don't know the musician side, the cartoons and, you know, all that stuff.
Yeah.
And then, of course, Facebook. But I keep reaching the limit. Then, you know, people drop off. Then I get more. But the mailing list, the philipingram.org.
Yeah.
Whether I'm doing stuff with Switch myself or. Yeah, I always put that on there. But I didn't put this one on there.
And if you want to hear this song again, you can go to YouTube and look up Ronnie Laws and Philip Ingram, I Can't Make You Love You. And it's there. The live performance is there.
Yeah, but I think. That's for another time, because I don't have. I'm about out on those CDs, because they had CDs too with that, where I put that.
Okay. Well, they can get in contact with you with the information you just put up.
Yeah, we have to get more. And I know Dick Maturity is like, okay, Philip, we got to talk. So.
Okay. This has been all that I knew it would be, and then some.
Well, thank you for inviting me. I actually had a lot of fun.
Yeah, we thank you for accepting the invitation.
Coco called me one day and she texted me. She's like, she told me, some folks, she said, you may not like them. I mean, especially Lynn, she's texting me. She said, but I did a show and then they asked me to be co-host. I'm like, really? Okay, we texted me.
See, what Coco actually put on there was, Lynn is going to be your best friend next to me. And this is why you should come on this show. So
your life will be forever changed. Your life will be forever changed.
Well, Lynn, I'm going to have to show you the actual text. No,
the whole, everybody in here already knew who you were, but I know that they have a whole new appreciation and love for you as our spiritual brother and a very talented musician. Continue your journey. Jehovah continue blessing you. You know I love you, bro.
Of course. If I didn't love you, I wouldn't be here. I'm sorry.
Okay.
But Lynn,
I don't even have nothing to say after that.
But Lynn, come on, Lynn and Lex and Cam and Jam,
family now. We family. Yeah,
thank you. And Lachey, don't forget her. And
yeah, don't forget Lachey and Sicily.
And Sicily.
Yes. Thank you guys for that. You know, I'm always forgot about back here.
Oh, girl, we just met on Tuesday. Come on.
Thank you so much, Phil. Philip Ingram, y'all. Philip Ingram. Hope you have as good a time as we did. And we ain't even through with you.
No, not at all.
I appreciate your story, my brother.
Thank you for the time.
It's an honor, my brother.
Thank you. All right, that was awesome sauce. I appreciate you being here, Phil. Lady Coco and Lynn did an awesome job. That was awesome.
He made it easy. Phil made it easy. He really did.
Lynn might not think so.
Look, nothing I can't handle.
You and me, honey.
Thank you for coming to the show. I really appreciated those stories. That's why I took us off screen. I said, you know, we're going to let Coco and Lynn handle it. I was sitting back with my feet kicked up watching.
And Lex always trying to make us work. Don't let him pretend like, oh, he was just enjoying the interview. He just didn't want to do no work.
You know what? Talking to him and you guys before the show and seeing how he was clapping back, especially at you, Lynn, I said, you know what? Phil got it. He only need my help today. So I said, and I watched.
See, you all are giving me a bad reputation here.
Hey, Lex, come on, man. You and me.
Always, you know.
Listen. Every good dish needs some spice.
Of course,
thank you. You, Lynn.
Look, Cam. Thank you. That's what we got on the same color. You, my bruh.
No, it was fun. Had a lot of fun.
It was. Thank you all for joining us. We are not done. We are about to bring you a fire set from DJ Jam. He's going to bring you some just awesome music. So get ready, open your cameras, get on your feet, and he's about to do that thing. Let's go.
Yes, we're going to do a little freestyle today. But what we're going to do is start off with a classic. And we're also going to start off with a familiar voice.
You're jamming with DJ Jam.
Put some ones up in the chat if you can hear me. Let me know how it sound. Yes, we're going to go back. We're going to go back a little bit. Do a little freestyle. Here we go.
Like a bad man. You're jamming with DJ Jam. DJ Jam.
I never let it show all I-
Lost Music.
Life. do 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 anything. Nothing in the world that I won't do. I give the word to you if you want me to. I'll do anything, anything, anything.
Jamming with DJ Jam.
DJ Jam. DJ Jam.
Yes, yes. Everybody dance now. Thank y'all. Thank y'all for joining us. Incredible show, incredible evening.
You brought it, Jam. You brought it.
Had to make them dance after Phil.
I was trying not to fall out of my chair. You was I was over here.
Oh, yeah, I was having a good time, and I didn't want it to end, just like you guys don't want it to end. None of us want it to end. But guess what?
Sometimes I can keep going now. Hold on. I
know you do, but guess what? Our guest needs to go. We got some other things to do. It's late here on the West Coast. I know y'all tired of hearing me say that, and believe me, I get it. I get it. But we definitely want to be respectful of others' time, especially Phil, who came.
Come back and see us next Sunday, y'all. It ain't nothing but a party.
There we go.
Ain't nothing but a party.
Always a party. Phil, thank you very much. I wanted you to bring in your other half.
Okay.
And let us say hello.
I'll be right back.
All right now.
All right. And that's a picture of his other half.
There he is, right there.
Yes. We actually wanted the physical representation of
He's going to get her.
Yes, I know. But
Damn, I was over here. I'm sweating, dude. I'm like, I got to take a shower now.
That was the last song. Going to make you sweat. That's the last song.
I was trying to hide it.
Oh, no. See, I don't have my fan with me.
I know. I was down here going, okay, just a little bit of, woo, can't let y'all see. Hey, let's just see the sweat.
You ready for the commercial?
Oh, never let them see you sweat.
Hey, look, I'm loving the fact I get some hair blowing. Oh, good. Anyway, no, that's another story.
We got our whole little Beyonce look going on, you know.
I know, we had to try something new today. And you already know Lady Coco. My daughter and I were having this conversation about this hair. And Lady Coco had to do the deciding factor.
I was like, bring on the bangs, girl.
Bring on the bangs. That's it. As you see, I like them.
Lex, you smiling. I like it when you smile. That means you happy.
He think we silly. That's what it is.
I'm always smiling. What do you mean? I always smile.
Hello, lady. Oh, here we go.
Hello, Lady Coco.
Hey, Rebecca. How are you, girl?
I'm doing good. How are you?
Good.
Nice to meet you, Sister Ingram.
Yes.
This is me, Esposa Rebecca.
Here, let me turn this off because it really whitewashes me.
Well, you shouldn't be so white.
We ain't touching that, girlfriend. We ain't touching that.
This is Lex. Lex. Where's your wife?
Pop in. Where you at?
Where you at?
Sisley.
I'm right here.
We can't see you.
We can't see you, girl. Oh, there she go.
Nice.
Sisley, this is my wife, Rebecca.
Nice to meet
Lex,
you.
Lex, they the ones that.
It's nice to meet you, Rebecca. We've heard Lynn so much. Wrote,
she's ignorant.
Thank you. I do my best.
Hi,
Lynn.
Nice to meet you.
DJ Cam, DJ Jam, and they jam.
Hey, good to
meet you. Y'all both was jam. Oh, there's his other half.
The better half.
The Leia. I remembered it. I told you I was going to remember that.
Oh,
I
remember. Oh, had to get in there too.
Hi, Mike. How are you?
Yeah,
I'm good. Good to see you.
Nice.
There goes Jam.
And they maxed out.
See, I just want to say something right here. Uh-huh. Y'all done ganged up on me. That's not fair.
There's Lachey. You got Lachey.
Hey, there's Lachey.
Lachey likes to hide back there, but y'all done ganged up on me.
Come on, Lachey. Come on, Lachey.
You got Sophia
the perfect
too.
Head, Lynn.
Come on with it, Lachey.
Where's Sophia?
There's Lachey. She's running the background.
This is my wife, Rebecca.
Nice to meet you.
Hi, Miss Rebecca. How are you?
Doing good.
Miss Rebecca, look, everybody got their other half on there.
See, thank you. I was looking for mine, but it's that's okay.
That's funny.
It's handsome.
Oh, but on the serious side,
they
did a very nice show. They had it was very organized and everything. And
very good.
The friends, the most friends that I was getting so many texts, so many people didn't make it. Yeah. So they want to know if there's a recording that they can look at later. Because I got a whole bunch of folks like, well, I'm like, well, honey, you should have got on.
A lot of people saw it on YouTube and Twitch, yeah. Though.
Right. Yeah, there, it was heading to 200 on YouTube. I don't even know.
Guys, and some saw it on Twitch, I told, but not everybody. Maybe put it on the flyer next time. Like, if Max is out, have the link so they'll know.
Yeah. For next time.
So when you come back, we can do this next time, and definitely when Switch comes here to Atlanta, Lachey and Lex and Cicely and Lynn Rowe will definitely be there as your special guest. Thank you. And we can meet the lovely Rebecca in person. And whoever needs to fly in, Lady Coco, Sophia, Cam Jam.
I'm gonna be there when he comes.
Were you saying something? I just woke up. I'm sorry.
No, yeah, You do you feel me right now? Come on. You heard me.
But seriously, they did a really nice job.
Yeah, he did.
Thank you.
Phil made it easy, Rebecca. Phil made it so easy. You know, he had so many interesting stories. He loves to talk and he's very entertaining with it, so Phil was like the ideal guest, really. He really
well, plus I was talking about them along the way too.
I'm glad he didn't embarrass me.
Well, actually I did.
He did not.
Not at all.
We'll save that for when he gives the talks. I'm sure he says right. Something there sometime. You'd be like, no, he didn't just say that from the stage, but anyway. We appreciate you letting us borrow him.
Yes. And thank you for coming on and saying hello to us as well. It's been an honor. It really has been. Thank you.
It's mine. It's just like, I'm glad that he was able to do this. And I know that he enjoys it immensely. Yes. And especially with the lockdown and he hasn't been in shows. I know that one thing I do know is that he loves to perform. He loves to entertain. So,
yeah. Speaking of which, what happened to just call my name and I'll come running. What happened to that song? I'm just saying, but that's okay.
Yeah, you can sing it out.
Yeah, come on.
The interview went longer.
But hey,
we got a few minutes.
You can sing us on out. I know everybody.
And you can sing us on out while the folks leave and log off and end the meeting. They can go off.
You think they're really going to log off while he's singing?
we already know they're not, but we'll get that song in because we want to hear it. So.
That's actually a good idea because usually we play the outro music.
We
don't have to play the outro music. We don't have to.
Okay, but see, she gonna leave because she done heard all this stuff. She's like, I mentioned that we've been married 27 years. Mm-hmm. In the chat, there's a whole bunch of happy anniversaries.
Oh, that is
yes.
So
in fact, Lex and his wife Cicely here. Their anniversary was two weeks ago.
That's right.
He sang for them.
Another anniversary while you're still in lockdown. That is an accomplishment.
Yeah, it ain't no joke.
Now you know that if we don't get on each other's nerves during lockdown, being together all the time, we got something going on.
Yeah, you're right. You got
so now we so there will be a link.
Yes,
for the recording. Because people are asking me, I'm like,
so
she's gonna go.
Lex is gonna work it out for you.
Yeah,
okay.
Lex is gonna work it out for you.
Nice to meet you all.
Okay, Rebecca, thank you.
You too.
I'm gonna let him continue to entertain.
Hi.
Thank you for letting us share his gift.
Oh, my pleasure.
All right, okay, girl. See you soon.
Yes, the friends are waving at you as well.
Yes.
Okay.
He looked like he looking for something.
Well, because I done closed everything down. I thought I was done.
never.
We can wait. And so what we'll do is
no, we'll, I got it.
We'll let you have the stage again. And when you get done singing, that's the end of the show.
That's it.
We will not play any more music. It will be time to.
But you know what? You already know folks going to be mad that left.
That's all right. We're going to start kicking.
They can log. Somebody call somebody. They can log back in.
Look, Coco, the ones
don't do that.
I'm playing.
The ones that we kick out.
Somebody told me they were on and got kicked out. I'm like, what?
Uh-oh.
No. We didn't kick anybody out. But if they left on their own, that's not our issue.
No, Zoom be tripping sometime.
Yes, it does.
It actually put me out right after I was playing the intro.
It put you out.
And I couldn't get back in for a long time.
So you want to hear the story behind this?
Yes.
Go ahead, Phil.
Yes, we do.
Because the story makes this. So, you know, I told you how we wrote it, you know, me and Denzel and Ken Curry, right?
Yeah.
So this was 1984, and Denzel was just starting to work with, Russell Simmons. Excuse me, Russell Simmons of Def Jam Records.
Thank you, name dropper. Thank you.
So Russell was just starting Def Jam Records around that time. And so, they were doing a lot of rap stuff. And Denzel and Russell were really good friends. And he said he's going to pitch this to Russell because they got this girl. She actually works at the company. She says, Allison Williams, a new upcoming artist. I said, okay, cool. So they fly me to New York. I told you I do all the backgrounds and everything. I'm like, since I'm in New York, let me go to Ohio and visit my family. I get home, and literally the day I get home, I get a call from Denzel, and he's real calm, and I think he's teasing me. He said, man, can you come back to New York? I'm like, why would I want to come back to New York? He said, no, I'm serious. I'm like, Denzel, come on, man, what's going on? He said, no, I'm serious. I'm like, for what? And then he got quiet, and then he said, the second engineer, and it's not like today where you got digital. This was back when you had tape. Says the second engineer hit a button, all 24 tracks went in to record. I said, are you serious? He said, yes. And they wasn't hearing nothing, and it was so much that they can't edit it back. I said, you serious? I said, so why are you so calm? So I don't kill somebody. Because you know, it's live. You had to call the musician. I said, are you serious? And so I had to, so they lost a lot of money because he had to, you know, got the same players and everything. I had to fly back out. And then, we do the same thing, you know, you capture it, but you never know because you don't have anything to compare it to, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Especially live. So anyway, because they, you know, do a few takes. So then the song sat, and I was working with Al McKay of Earth, Wind & Fire.
Yeah.
You started.
Very good, Phil.
He was producing the Temptations, that Treat Her Like a Lady album.
Yes.
I did a bunch of backgrounds on there. Matter of fact, the opening song is a song called Running that Zane Giles and Tony Haynes and I wrote, and I'm playing the keyboards and singing background. Doing that album, I said, hey man, I did this song with Denzel way back in 84, and it's just sitting. And I gave it to him for the Temptations, and he was gonna cut it. And right at that time, this was in 89, right at that time, Denzel calls me, he says, hey man, they're gonna put out this song we did. I said, are you kidding me? I said, I just gave it. He said, no, don't give it to somebody. I'm like, so I had to call up Al and say, guess what? He said, okay, no problem. But he, you know, he did cut Running, which I was happy about. Anyway, so that song came out and went to number 3 R&B. But
I love that.
That's what happened. It was, yeah, I had to do
her vamping on that is crazy.
The what?
Her vamping and vibing on that song is crazy.
Oh, yeah. So we just had fun. But yeah, to do it again was like, so, oh yeah, that second engineer lost his job.
Of course he did.
I wouldn't believe so.
I'm over here dying to hear you say he hit record.
But see, now like with Logic and Pro Tools, you have like 99 undo.
Yeah.
I mean, but back then, I mean, if it was one track, you know, you could, no, he did a whole section. Because you know how it is when you're not hearing something and then you wonder what's going on?
Right.
And then next thing you know, you're like,
He did.
That was a mess. Anyway, so let me pull this up.
All right.
And it should play it if I do this.
We appreciate it, Phil. Really, we're not taking it for granted.
Not at all. I don't want to hear it.
Everybody, mute.
Y'all talking all that smack, saying you want to you appreciate it. I don't believe you talking about Lynn, talking about Lady Coco. I believe Lex and sis. Okay, here we go. Here you go. Ever had a love that you could call on when you were in trouble? Ever had a love who comes to you on the devil? There's no need to look no further. I'm waiting right here for you. Oh, all you gotta do, dial my number. I'm gonna come running. I'm gonna be right by your side, right by your side, holding your hand, baby. Now, I'm gonna come running. But if Lynn calls me, you'll never have to fear that I won't have time for you when you worry. 'Cause if you need me near, baby, just call and out. I'm gonna be there in a hurry. Yeah. All you gotta do is snap your fingers, and I'm gonna be there for you. Oh, when your life's feeling low, don't you know I'm gonna go right by your side, babe. Oh. I have to sing with my fingers, 'cause when I'm doing those runs, I gotta make sure I'm doing everything right. Baby, why you crying all alone? You know this song is old when you talk about dial my number on the telephone, 'cause now you just press some buttons, and then you just pick up the phone and say, hey Siri, can you call my baby? Oh, tells you the song is old. Teardrop phone.
Sorry, I don't know who your mother is.
In she fact, said, you hear Siri? I don't know who you are. I don't know who your mother is. Siri, I was teasing, okay? Just messing all up on myself. Here we go. Ready? And come on. Let's go to that bridge one more time since Sally got in here. You're crying all alone. Dial my number 777-9311, baby. Oh, that was the time. I'm gonna be right there before the next teardrop falls, baby. I'm gonna come running to you. Oh, even though my shoes might wear out, I'm gonna jump and shout, gonna call your name, baby. Oh, and if you ever need a friend, I'm gonna be there right to the end, like I'm sitting here with this DJ project right to the end, baby. Lynn trying to get me, Coco trying to get me, Sicily trying to get me, Jam and Cam and Lex, everybody's trying to get me. Mr. Shame, Mr. Shame, Mr. Shame, call my name, baby, baby, baby.
Oh, okay.
Man, I like that little last little part. Can you do that one time?
We all want that one.
I had to save the best for last.
Thank you, Phil. I appreciate that. Thank you.
Girl, come on, girl.
All right. Well, thank you, everyone. That really is the end. So for have a wonderful evening. We're so happy you came. We know you enjoyed this.
I had a lot of fun.
Seriously. Thank you, Phil. Thank you.
Thank you, Coco, for asking me.
All right. Thank you for saying yes. Thank you for saying yes.
Yes. Cam Jam and Lynn.
Thank you.
Until next time, Phil.
Until next time. Thank you for coming.
Make sure you give me that link so I can send it to these everybody and their mama. That was
That's right.
We'll take care of that. Tell him to calm down. Tell him to calm down.
Kelly, okay. Mom, and them, and everybody, I said, hey, what's up? See you next time. Come on, next time. We're going to send this link to you and come on and join us on the project next weekend.
Tell them to come next week.
Sounds good. All right.
Mom and them. Tell Mom and them. Okay. Bye-bye, Phil. Thank you.
Good night.
Good night, Phil.
Good night, everyone.
Uh-oh, he's gone for real. The music is done. Thank y'all. Y'all got a treat. It's like when you stay at the movie theater and they show a trailer at the end of the credits that you didn't know the trailer was coming. And then people, it ain't no more trailers.
Oh, bye, Sylvia. I see you laughing, girl. Bye, girl. For real, she's right. There's nothing else coming.
Unless y'all want to see me sip on this bourbon I'm about to get.
All right, Maurice, see y'all next time. Have a good one. Okay.
Love you. Next time, babe.
Joyce, thanks for coming again. See ya.
Project 2020 next Sunday.
All right, Joyce, call you. That means you too. I see you way over there back in the somewhere, somewhere over there. Okay, Zena. Have a good one. All right, Michelle. Y'all, thank you for coming. It was fantastic.
So much. Next time. Cody, always good seeing. I'll be seeing you all weekend long, child. We'll be at the same party.
That girl parties. She is the party. Her and Candle. Hey, Candle.
Hey, Sue. Sue, that's my girl right there. Sue Gaither, that is my girl. Sue's like the promoter. When you have a show happening, Sue, get the people coming to your show.
Thanks, she Sue. Good to see you.
Sue is the girl. Good seeing you.
I'm going to do a shameless plug. You see that big DJ Project 2020 down there, Cash App? Feel free to donate to us. If you enjoyed yourself today, come back next time. We appreciate you for being here.
Yep. Cash App, DJ Project 2020.
No, over there. That one. Down there. Yes. Have a good one. Hi, Sue. All right, Lance Thomas. I don't see you on the camera.
Bye, Stephen Deb. Bye, Stephen Deb. Hey, girl. We miss you guys. Seeing you too.
Next week.
Oh, love you, girl.
Come back.
Hi, Carol.
Who is that? Have a good night. Is that Steve? Good night, Michelle. That's Steve. Hey, Ken. Ken is the brother that Phil mentioned. He co-wrote that song. It was Just Call My Name, right? That's the brother who co-wrote it right there. Ken Curry.
Okay, I don't see Ken. Is he still?
He's right at the top, right now, right in the middle.
He's waving.
Oh, hey, I see you now. Oh, yeah, I love the background. Is that real? Yeah, I want to be out there. I don't want to be here.
It's as real as you want it to be.
I know, right? Just like this one?
Yes.
Oh, that was Phillips Damaged Goods they were holding up, his cover. Okay, right. Got it, Deb. Got it. Got it. I'm going to have to listen to that song tonight.
Stephen Deb, I love your background too. Have a good night, though.
Ken. Hey, that was Phil as a little boy that she was holding up. The picture that Debbie's holding up, that's Phil as a little boy.
Wow. Oh. Yeah, I saw that online earlier. Yeah. Oh,
that don't look nothing like him. I don't know why, but that's cute, Debbie. Thank you. Kim, thank you so much. We're going to check out that brunch place you told us about as soon as we get a free minute to go.
Kenneth, thank you for joining us.
Thank you. I hope you appreciated that shout out, bro, man.
Thanks for joining us, Ken. Kareen, have a good one.
All right, y'all. It's been fun. Good night.
Yeah. It's been a blast.
Christy, have a wonderful evening.
All right.
Christella, how many people?
I feel guilty because it's still kind of early here, but
yeah, it's 10:06 here though.
Yeah.
And I know everybody's on different time zones, so you know.
Coco, y'all supposed to be working on something anyway, ain't it? You didn't talk. They didn't talk to you about it.
No.
Okay. Well, I ain't gonna.
Who didn't talk to me about it?
If you all keep talking, they keep listening.
Yeah, I know. That's why I'll get with you.
No. Okay. All right.
Old school. Peace out, everybody.
Two fingers.
Like, I'm turning off my camera for a minute.
There you go. Cut the camera off there, Lee. How y'all be doing a little disappearing thing? I want a camera.
Yeah, y'all have that disappearing thing. Like
Star Trek. Woo,
how being do you up. Do that?
We can't tell you. It's a family secret.
Oh, okay. Okay.
OBS. OBS.
I don't have OBS.
I don't either.
Yeah.
Sorry.
You got that smooth transition.
See you next time.
They pull in the camera blocker.
Good night.